Thank you, dear Pastor, for your kind words. Pastor Jenny, Pastor Glenroy, all the ministers here. What a distinct honor. What a great privilege to be with you this evening and to grace this pulpit to share with you from the Word of God. I always look forward to come whenever the time is appropriate, the opportunity is given. I'm always willing to make whatever necessary sacrifice to be here. I want to thank this church in advance over the years for their great input and continuing to do so in the work we started some years ago in Londonville. In spite of the many challenges, we are still moving on. There's always room for improvement. But one thing, we want to make sure that Jesus is lifted up, his name is glorified. And this is what Sister Ram Kisun and myself, we are continuing doing. She sent her love to you, as many of you know. She got an imbalance problem. Very difficult for her to move around freely. But Holiness Revival always got a very special place in her heart. So continue to pray for her. Last month, the month of March, I had two quick trips overseas. In Miami, we had the distinct honor, my wife and myself, to take our last son to a university to continue his studies in the culinary arts for his bachelor's degree in Johnson and Wales. And it was very interesting, very challenging. When we arrived there, I told Pastor one of the main documents we didn't carry. And they put us in the room for 3 hours. And we thought for a while that they were going to send us back. But all the while I said, favor, 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 with Trinidad flavor. And after they viewed his passport and etc., they allow him to go. And we had to submit the documents at a later date. But he's doing well. And then soon as I came back, one of our dear friends, even from Holiness here, our Italian brother, Reverend Mark Tarantino, my associate friends for over 30 years, his mom passed away. It was a request of the family that I should come and be the speaker of the funeral service. It was a very large funeral service in New Jersey. So I had to turn around after a few days and get back there, not much sleep after a few days, but to be with them to share that service. And since then, just keep moving along. But I'm glad to be with you. Get your Bibles. Get your pencil. Get your paper. I'm sure you like to take some notes because of the nature of the message. I never promise, and I will never promise you what I'm going to say you never heard before. So often people say, well, I'm going to share something that you never heard before. But maybe what I'm going to share, you heard it before. But so often, as we know, when something is good, you need to hear it more than once. If a particular dish is nice, amen, you got to cook it as often as possible. But there's always a freshness in the Word of God. Like I always say, the Word of God never gets stale. Every time you minister the Word of God, there's always a fresh revelation, but heading in the same direction. I want to talk a little tonight about destroying or dismantling barrenness. And I'm going to take this message in a step that I believe that will be all-inclusive tonight. Destroying, dismantling, or breaking barrenness. There are two verses of scripture I want to use as a starter for this message, and there are several other verses I will be highlighting. to complement this message this evening. One is in the form of a question, and the other verse is the answer. Jeremiah chapter 32. Chapter 32 and verse 27. If possible, just put a little dot by this verse that you can give it some further meditation. Or from verse 26, it says, "Then came the word of the Lord unto Jeremiah," God's servant, God's mouthpiece, "saying, Behold," and I've said it so many times that every time in Scripture the word "behold" is used, there is something important that we need to know. "May I have your attention? I am the Lord, the God of all flesh." Watch this now. "Is there anything too hard for me? Is there anything too hard for me to do?" Now what we're going to do in the same chapter, we're going to back up a little and look at verse 17. Same chapter, chapter 32, verse 17. "Ah, Lord God, behold, thou hast made the heaven and the earth by thy great power and stretch out arm, and there is nothing too hard for me." Is there anything too hard for God to do? Absolutely. There is nothing too hard for him to do. And then you don't have to turn to this location, but in Luke chapter 1, verse 37, a well-known verse, "With God, nothing shall be impossible." What is impossible with man is possible with God. Man can only go at a particular distance, but God can go all the way. Man is limited, but God is unlimited. I do not believe I have to spend a considerable amount of time in describing the word barrenness, but that word came from the word barren. I am sure most of you in this congregation have a clear idea concerning the meaning of barrenness. When we talk about barrenness, we are talking about unable to produce or to bring forth. Unable to produce. A measure of stagnation. No productivity. And taking that into consideration, dearly beloved, I am sure all of us can come to the conclusion that is not a pleasant condition to be in. Where there is no growth, where nothing is able to come forth or to produce. Living in a situation like that, there is a high level of disappointment, embarrassment, and ridicule. Watch me now, how I'm moving on in this message. Throughout the scriptures, especially in the Old Testament, we read about barren land, that was not fertile, that brought a great measure of disappointment to those who had great expectation for it to produce. We talk about the scriptures about fruit trees that was unable to produce, that was barren. As a matter of fact, in the days of Jesus, Matthew chapter 20 and verse 19, one time it tells us that Jesus and his disciples passed by. They saw this fig tree. Jesus had great expectation of this fig tree. Of course, he was hungry, needed a little to keep him going. But to his disappointment, the tree was barren. He placed a curse on the fig tree. It was not a demonstration of anger, but it was not producing. He was not pleased with it. Then we will read in the scriptures of many women who was barren, unable to conceive. And that's not a good situation to be in. But I found out in the scriptures some keys, some principles of how God could put an end to that. How God could turn around the situation from nothing to something, from empty to plenty. Give the Lord a hand of praise, somebody. As far as technology is concerned, we are living in the age of press button. But with the word of God, there is no press button, Pastor. There's always a process to arrive to the product. And presenting this message today, or this evening, there are some principles on how barrenness can be destroyed. Number one, through the medium of prayer. Through the medium of prayer. Now I want to take a woman, for example, who was barren, and show you in the scriptures how she prayed and talked to God. And what appeared to be impossible, God made it possible. When we talk about prayer, to me, that's not a problem. Because everybody you talk today to, they're praying. Prayer is communicating to God. If there's a disaster, or somebody gets hurt, or there's an earthquake, the first thing people say, we will pray. They see you going through some distress, I will keep you in my prayers. All over the world, the problem is not praying. People praying. But what's the problem? Who they praying to? For the scripture teaches us, the prayer of the upright is his delight, but the sacrifice of the wicked is an abomination. The scripture teaches us in relation to prayer, the eyes of the Lord is upon the righteous. He can hear our supplication. Which Lord? There are so many lords today in this world. England got a bunch, but they still can't beat back Trinidad. Like I always say, Pastor, we have so many lords today. Lord of the hardware, Lord Baker, Lord Shoemaker. Like I always say, some of them can't even recite Calypso, much less to sing, but it's Lord this and Lord the other. But this Lord I'm referring to, who can answer prayer. I preached a few weeks ago on Resurrection Sunday, and I put a title for the message, The Tomb Became a Failure.
Because the tomb was supposed to hold on the body of Jesus, keep the body of Jesus. But they couldn't do it. The stone rolled away, and that Lord I'm referring about came out alive. That's the Lord I'm talking about. A Lord who not used to be, but a Lord of the now. For he is with us tonight. He's alive and alive forevermore. That is the Lord who can answer prayer. And every prayer that is directed to him, amen, there is an answer. But answer prayer is not always yes. Sometimes answer prayer is no, but we can't take no for an answer. But God's agenda sometimes is different from our agenda. But here is a woman I want to talk about who was barren. Now in scriptures there are a number of women that was barren. Sarah, but God opened her womb. Rachel, God opened her womb. There was a time the children of Israel was in bondage. They were delivered in the hands of the Philistines because of the hardness of their heart. God needed a man to restore them and bring deliverance. And he opened the womb of a woman. Her husband's name was Manoah. And Samson came on the scene. But the woman I want to highlight who was barren, that touched the heart of God and was able to conceive, her name is Hannah. Hannah. The Bible tells us there was a man by the name of Elkanah who had two wives. And may I announce to you that Elkanah days are over. that is something of the past, so don't think about that. Those days are over. One of them was able to conceive. But Hannah, so to speak, was unfortunate, if I may use that word, was not blessed to the extent to conceive. It was a matter of concern because daily she was provoked by the other woman. And if she was a trainee, I don't want to take this pulpit to talk about the kind of words. Let me go into that. Not tonight, like the politicians say. I ain't going to go into that. I could imagine she was taunted. Words were thrown at her. Many times she had to walk with her head down, embarrassed. But what should she do? What did she do? She went to the temple. Are you hearing what I'm saying tonight? She did not go to places that she's not supposed to go and break the heart of God. She went into the house of God. She decided to communicate with God. Pray to God. That's a strong weapon tonight. There's no substitute for prayer. Her prayer was not one of complaining. Well, God, you know how it is. I know why. And I know if I had the wrong color of skin or living in the wrong location. No. That has nothing to do with that. Sometimes we need to put those limitations aside. Like I always say, when I started this ministry, I had a lot of limitations and I still have. As a matter of fact, before I got converted, I had a bunch of limitations. And the devil brought it back to me. Just to hinder me and to press me down and to complain and to gripe and to groan. To build a wall. I had to be careful when I said to build a wall, you know. You know, if you're watching American TV, you're in trouble, you know. A man building wall and so, you know. You know, I always tell the story and I will always say, had great limitations. Somebody said when I was small, my eyes were so big, I could have climbed a ladder on Monday and see everything was going to happen on Tuesday. But you know, but let me leave that aside. It was not prayer complaining. Her prayer was one that was consistent. There was no day off. Her desire was to get a hold of God and not to let him go. And that should be the desire of all of us, the pattern. Whether things in your favor or not in your favor, hold on to God in prayer. Don't let him go. You need him more than you think. It was prayer of confidence. Believing what she was praying for. Though from a human standpoint, it appeared to be impossible. God was able to make a way where there is no way. And even during her prayer, the prophet Eli, look at her. See her mumbling words and accuse her wrongfully. It's one thing to be in a position like that, being provoked. Otherwise, I know the pastor, the church know. You could take it from the Sunday school teacher, take it from the youth leader. When Brother Ramke is soon hitting me, boy, oh, go take that. Eli, the high priest, accuse her that she's drunk. The way she's mumbling her words. And even though for a while she was disappointed, she did not cease to pray. She did not abandon the mission. And folks, when you begin to travail and you begin to seek God for what appeared to be impossible, the devil do anything within his so-called power to hijack you, to deter you. Sometimes the mouth who used to kiss you will start biting you. The same people who used to treat you with such a high esteem, you become worse than the doormat. Don't give up. Keep talking to God. Like I always say, don't give up. The best is yet to show up. Give the Lord a hand of praise. Don't give up. The best is yet to show up. And look at the conclusion of this prayer. Verse 20, in 1 Samuel chapter 2, Hannah was able to conceive, brought forth a son, his name was Samuel. There was no black magic in that. That answer came, she didn't have to bury anything or tie up anything or chant any strange slogan. She just depended upon prayer, talking to God, communicating to God. Amen. And at the appropriate time, God was able to do, amen, what he desired to do. So breaking barrenness or dismantling, first weapon is prayer. Number two, declaring praises to God. The word praise means to adore. It means to exalt, giving God glory for what you believe in advance. But Brother Ramke Soon, how can you give God praise when things are not in your favor? If you continue like that, they will call the ambulance sooner or later and take you down there, you know. How will people accept them from a human standpoint, like I say, coming on the road here and beat them? Well, let me talk about beat them. But a little further, my car shut down. And I get up in the middle of the road with a tambourine. Thank you, Jesus, my car shut down. Thank you. Who would that be? Who would believe me? In the middle of the road. So what I'm trying to say, it appeared to be impossible to sing praises unto God when things are not going your way. But in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verses 21 to 23, there was a popular king by the name King Jehoshaphat. You read that story? He was outnumbered. It seems as though his time and his people was coming to an end. The enemy was ready to destroy him. But he called the people and he said, sing praises. Amen. And they began to sing and they began to give God praise. Amen. Even before the battle. And you read the rest of the story. God gave them victory over the children of Ammon. Blessed be the name of the Lord. We must realize that sometimes the battle is not ours. The battle is the Lord. Stand still and see the salvation of God. Amen. He is able to fight. Let us continue to give him praise in advance. I look at Danny, and I say, Daniel, his life was threatened. If he continued to pray and call upon his God, he'll be thrown to the den of hungry lions. They were hungry. But the Bible tells us, when they decided to throw Daniel in there, he didn't look for a top-notch lawyer. He didn't write a placard and walk down the street and said, you see what they cause? Unjust, unjust, unjust. Unjust, unjust, unjust. He didn't say that. To sue them. But in Daniel chapter 6 verse 10, when he knew the writing was signed, he went into his house and he began to pray and to give praises like he always do. Amen. I guess he was saying to himself, not being ignorant, I know the lions are hungry. I know they're counting the hours waiting for me. But I am going to give God praise in advance, because my God who created the lions got power to tame the lions. Give the Lord a hand of praise. God is able to turn around the situation. He continued to pray. And then in Acts chapter 16, Paul and Silas, they were placed in prison. For what? Preaching the gospel. Their backs were bleeding, made to sleep on cold concrete. If they had concrete in those days. Not given anything to drink. Ridicule. They didn't look for one of the turnkey and said, listen, I have a little change here. You could give me an axe or blade there, you know. And you pick up that, you know, don't worry. Wang, you know, when I come out, I'll go fix you up. They didn't do that. But at midnight. Let me come down a little bit passes, all right? But at midnight, time to sleep. Amen. They began to pray and sing praises on to God. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. How can prisoners rejoice? I don't hear about prisoners singing and rejoicing. No, I hear them complaining, murmuring, how they could make a jailbreak. But these were different prisoners. And when they started to praise God, amen, it seems as though the praises begin to touch, amen, God. Somebody said God got happy with the duet singing that he began to stamp his feet. Go on, boys. Go on, boys. Go on, boys. Go on, boys. And all of a sudden, a quake it started, which was known as an earthquake. And it shook the very foundation of the prison. And everyone's bands were loose. I know nothing about any good earthquake. I never read about a good earthquake. When it comes, it saved people, it killed people. But God know how to take that which is evil. Give the Lord a hand of praise. That which is intended to work against you, and let it work on your behalf. Don't underestimate God. I can go on and go on and go on, but time will not permit me. So the first principle in breaking or destroying barrenness is prayer. Praises. Number three, making a prophetic declaration on behalf of the need. In 2 Kings chapter 4 verse 16, this is about the Shunammite woman, and I come into that now. It is so easy. I notice in the church world today to make prophetic declaration. Everybody doing that. But it's not a matter of making a prophetic declaration like that. You can't do it in the flesh and expect results. You have to be inspired by the Holy Ghost. I've seen enough of that in my lifetime. People get emotionally moved, and they say this, and they say that, and they say that and the other. But I say making a prophetic declaration in relation to 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 16. The Shunammite woman recognizing the man of God, and I'm going to come back to that, where she told her husband, and that was a good relationship between a husband and wife. She didn't do nothing without consulting her husband. Yes, she said, "My dearly husband, I noticed the man of God Elisha has passed by. You ever see him?" "Yes." "What happened to him?" "You make him a little room, bake a little bread, give him a little stool, put a little candle, and etc." And after consulting with her husband, get the approval, and I'm going to come back to that, amen, she did it. Elisha was impressed. He was blessed. He told his servant Gehazi, "That woman who showed us that kindness, go and find out her need." When I talked to her, she was a rich woman. She didn't want money. She had plenty, plenty clothes, new shoes for every occasion, everything she had in her favor. At past, she was barren. She couldn't have a baby. And he came back and he said, "Servant of God, this woman, of everything you could think about, but you have a great need. She's barren." And Elisha said, I guess in words like this, "No problem. Problem solved." And he went to the woman, I guess he thanked her for her kindness. And he said, he make a prophetic declaration. "At the right season, you shall conceive." Are you hearing? She was barren. But he prophesied in advance, "At the right season, your womb shall be open and you shall conceive and bring forth a son." And as he said it, it came to pass. But let me warn you about something tonight in making prophetic declaration. While we're entitled to do that, like I said earlier, we must not be directed by the flesh, and because somebody doing it, I want to do it. I believe all the promises of God, all his benefits are for his children. We are his children, not his stepchildren. But I am one of the firm belief, in order to make prophetic declaration with the expectation to see it come to pass, your life have to be in alignment with the word of God. You can't live crooked and live how you want. Bring it forth. Let it come to pass. Let it come plenty. What does the Bible say? "No good thing would he withhold to them." Continue the verse now. The word "walk" in this context, that means who live uprightly. It's amazing. There are a lot of people who know how to declare the benefits of God. You ever hear them say, "My God shall meet all my needs according"? That's right. Is it called glory? Yes. "And he will do this. And he will do that." They know how to declare in a prophetic way the needs, what they want. But they don't know how to declare how to live. They don't know them verse of scriptures at all. Only what is convenient. I go get this and I go get that and I go get that and I get that. But what about the other verses? The process in getting it. How you should live. What God expects of you. It work hand in hand. We have to make sure our lives are aligned to the word of God. And when it is aligned in the word of God, then we have the authority to make those declarations, believing it will come to pass. You cannot live a wayward and a disobedient and rebellious life and expect God to fulfill his promises in your life. I don't know if you ever feel this is false preaching, but this is in line with the word. The Shunammite woman, he made that declaration. So when we begin to align our life in the word of God, this has nothing to do with your technique, your skill, or your ability, or color of your skin, or the standard of your education. But as long as you're in line with the word of God, you're entitled to make prophetic declaration, because God is going to bring it to pass. It may not come Sunday, it may not come Monday, but it will come at the appropriate time. When you know how to learn how to wait upon God, like David said in Psalm 40, I waited patiently on the Lord, and he inclined unto me, and he heard my cry. He brought me up also out of the horrible pit. Bless the name of the Lord. And he established my goings, and he put a new song in my heart. It worked both ways. And I tell you, I'm finishing. Prayer, praises, prophetic declaration. And now I have to slow down in this, because there's a lot of explanation with this. In dismantling or breaking barrenness, plant a seed. Oh, hold it. You size me up now with this seed business. Hold it. Let me not put your minds in confusion and put you in a measure of comfort. I believe in planting seed. In the church world today, most people believe a seed is only dollars. And people manipulate that. They make conventions out of that. One preacher said some time ago, they will not have me to preach in a convention because I don't know how to raise offering. I said, hallelujah! I got to raise offering. Raise offering for what? I got to raise what God promised to give us, Pastor. No, I don't have to raise that. I'm not gifted in that area. But here was the Shunammite woman. Let me back up now. She sowed a seed. It was not dollars and cents. A seed is not only dollars and cents. Tell them, Brother Ramki soon say so. Every act of your life is a seed. The words you speak is a seed. The deeds you do is a seed. Are you hearing me tonight? So give the man of God bread, a stool, a candle. That was a seed that opened the door to meet her need. God sowed the first seed. When man fell in Genesis 3 and 15, he said, I'll send a seed to Satan. You'll give him some trouble, but your trouble will not able to deter, hinder him from fulfilling his mission. He will destroy you. That seed was Jesus. And because of the effect of that seed that was sown, it affected the whole wide world and still affecting. Because of that seed, I am what I am. Because of that seed, there is hope for the hopeless and help for the helpless. In the secular world, a seed brings forth of its kind. I never hear a farmer say that he plant tomatoes and he get cucumber. If that happen, he having problems with the eyes, he reaping from his neighbor garden. Are you hearing me, folks? Bring forth of its kind. Is that right? Is that making sense? But I have discovered, and I speak personally for myself, in sowing seeds, it differs in the kingdom of God. I believe in sowing seed. I believe in giving offering. I don't believe in that. But I want to tell you, it's not like how some people believe. If you sow $100, if you give $100, you'll get $1,000. Pastor, it don't always work that way. So I am not going to build up your expectation and build your hopes high. You give that and you'll get that. And when it come to pass, you say, a thief and a robber, who spare me of that, because I ain't going to tell you that. Sometimes you sow a seed financially and it brings good health. But what sense you get plenty money and you have no peace? What sense you have plenty food and you have no appetite? What sense you have a big house and whole night you're looking at the big chandelier, it could fall and mash up your head, you can't sleep? It makes no sense. So I want to spread it across the board, Pastor. Yes, we need to plant. We need to sow. Given, it shall be given. And some people just know the latter part, and it shall be given. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. Bless God! Or whatever the part, give. Yes, we need to sow. Are you hearing me? But it's not only dollars and cents. If you could get up and take a lawnmower and cut a widow yard, sow that seed. If you're in a position that you could cook a good plate of food and give somebody, sow that seed. I used to look forward for that, you know, people cooking a plate. You know my story, huh? I used to be at Columbus Square. There where I used to live there in Woodford Square. Living in the Salvation Army. And you talk about food used to come, Jenny, on Sunday, Sister Jenny. Trucks only come in. Roti, Dalpuri, this, that. A man have a case and he feel they're going to send him for 10 years. He give him 10 bucks of food. He feel that will help him. And if you say, I'm collecting, I'm hiding. Where you think I can't eat all that? I'm selling to those who come late. Yes, I used to sell cheap. They used to come on a dollar a box. They couldn't come. Give me a dollar. I passed by the other place and I tell him, Dolly, yes, the boy used to be here. No? Really. Listen, I don't say Peter said that humor. I say it because look where God brought me from. Whatever we can do. With the right attitude, with good intention, let's sow that seed. We may have a little, but we want to do it. We are not waiting on people just like the 5 barley loaves and the 2 fish. What a difference it made! Not when the little boy put it in the disciples' hands, but when it went in the hands of Jesus. Whatever that seed is, act of kindness, whatever. I won't go into details, so I won't be standing accused here. But whatever God put in your heart to do of helping someone. But the greatest seed is Jesus. 49 years ago passed, and I'm now celebrating, as I say, 14. Next year is a big 50, you know, in ministry. 49 years ago, at the old George Street Market, young lady from Ohio. I was so desperate, and I cannot... Look, please forgive me. I cannot stop saying this. I walk into that place with the expectation to rob somebody. The need for days. This young lady sitting on a stool with a black book gaze up and said, "The man with the long hair to the back, Jesus sent me to you." And I told you many times, what was my reaction? Desperate, hopeless and helpless, a white girl, Jesus sent her to me. I go marry she and go America. You know? No, look, I'm honest with you now. That is how I was thinking. Send she to me. Today is my day. Nobody is taking me on, they give me nothing. And it was the first time in many years, 1967, while people was whispering, "Hold your bags, watch that man," I was asked to come forward. First time I ever heard that somebody loved me. Jesus loved me. And as I always said, I didn't have to ask for excuse. The way I was smelling, everybody just move out. All clear. Some people were willing to leave the stall and all and run. And I gave my heart to the Lord. Pastor, that seed was sown. And look at the after effect of that seed. Give God praise today, somebody. Give God praise. So you never know when you sow that seed. First of all, that seed, which is God's love in the form of Jesus. How it can revolutionize, it can change, it can transform, and set the captives free. Breaking barrenness. Is there anything too hard for God? Do so. No. Worship team, sing me a song and I'm going to pray. I want to ask God for some direction how to do this altar call tonight. You understand? Go ahead. All right. I know in many areas this message is speaking to many people tonight. But you know what, Brother Glenroy? There are many people, while there might be barrenness, as far as your business is concerned, you haven't seen expansion. And in whatever area, there's spiritual barrenness. A lot of people, you're not producing for Jesus. They're the same way 10 years ago, the same way. God expects growth. God wants you to expand in the spiritual realm. He don't want you to continue to be like a baby and speak like a baby and behave like a baby. That barrenness must be broken. Spiritually, we need to advance and excel in the things of God with a high level of maturity tonight. Worship team, as you sing, we're going to ask the Lord to direct us tonight, first of all, for a call for those who need that seed, which is Jesus, to be sown in your life, that can break those chains, remove the guilty stains, and become number one in your life as your Lord and Master. We're going to come to that. Let's just sing. Oh Lord, thank you for your words. Thank you for your anointing this evening, Lord. Yes, Father, we thank you, Lord.
Take what I have known and break it all apart.
Oh, Lord, we thank you, Lord.
You, my God,
yes, Lord,
are greater still. Give me grace to see beyond this moment here,
Lord,
to believe that there is nothing left to fear. You alone are high above it all. For you, my God, are greater still. When no sky can take, no doubt restrains all you are. The greatness of our God.
Oh, so great tonight, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord. Worship team, just a moment. You are here tonight, you have heard this message. I am not here to push down anything in you. But what a wonderful privilege and opportunity you are getting tonight. Especially those of you have never accepted Jesus as your personal Savior. You are not here by mistake. God sowed the seed, and this seed want to come in your heart, which is Jesus, change you, transform you, forgive you for all your sins, change your direction. You never made him your Lord. Listen to what I'm saying. You never accepted him as your personal Savior. You never in a personal way say, Lord Jesus, I am deeply sorry for all my sins. Come into my heart and be the Lord of my life. A father, a mother, a son, or a daughter, a neighbor, a friend. Maybe you got this opportunity many times, but the Holy Spirit is speaking to you tonight. If there's one person who wants the seed, which is Jesus, to be sown in your heart tonight, that is where he desired to dwell, in your heart, to change you, to make you into a new creature.
I'd like to pray with you. Just lift up that hand, one person. Don't be ashamed, just lift it up if there's one person tonight. A young lady, a young man, a mother, a father, anywhere. You're not sure tonight, make it sure. Leave this place as you walk out with a confidence. I am anchored in Jesus. Then, in another direction, in somewhere or the other, we're not going to give you this mic to tell us, but you feel, in a way, there is no production, a measure of barrenness in your life, in your spiritual life. You're not advancing. You're the same way 10 years ago. You want to get closer with God. You want to get deeper with God. You want to understand the mysteries of God. Amen. I'd like to pray with you. The altar is open as I sing. And then maybe if you feel there is a way in your business or your finance or somewhere or the other, this message has appealed to you that you want to come. Let God break those barriers. Destroy barrenness. And let things begin to happen like you never see before. I'd like you to come tonight. Amen. So as we sing, come on, those need prayer in this area. Some are coming tonight. Yes. 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 Some are coming tonight. Yes. That's right. I did not believe that God allowed me to preach this message just like that. You're tired of just going in circles. Oh, yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes. Yes. Come a little closer. Come as many as possible. We want to say goodbye to barrenness in some way. And of course, not being ignorant to the fact that the first point I had on Hannah, I have spoken to so many women in the past, and I know it's not easy to deal with that. But if God did it for Hannah and did it for Sarah, God can do it for you as well. Come on tonight. Come on tonight. God didn't allow me to preach this message by mistake. Come on, yes. Come on, yes, yes. Oh, yes, Lord. Yes. Come on. This is the time to see the power of the word in demonstration. Oh, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, we're going to close off. Yes, more people are coming. Yes. You need that extra touch from God. Come on. You're tired. You're tired of it. Yes. Come on tonight. You want to make that declaration, but first you want your life to be aligned with the Word. Examine yourself so you can call forth things that the natural eyes have never seen. Knowing that God is able to bring it to pass, that what He promised, He's able to fulfill. Oh, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes, open your heart. Reach out to God tonight. This is your night. Reach out to act upon the word tonight. Yes, reach out tonight. Yes, yes, yes. Yes. This is the time for your breakthrough. This is the time for your breakthrough tonight. With God, nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible. What He did in the past, He can do it. The God of Hannah is our God. Yes, He's our God. That's the same God that rule and reign. Oh, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Oh, yes, Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord. Get ready for your breakthrough tonight. Get ready for your breakthrough tonight. Let faith come alive. Let faith. Yes, let faith come. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, 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 yes. Receive it from me right now. I speak forth the word tonight in your life. Just be touched, be blessed. Yoke be broken tonight. We decree and declare it is done upon you, the needs tonight. Whatever it is, as you align with the word, nothing is impossible. I call it forth upon you in Jesus' name. Yes, right now. Yes, give God praise. Right now, in the name of Jesus, I speak that word tonight. I decree and declare, yoke be broken, bind and loose. Yes. Devil, you're a liar. Yes,
build it. That fear that you bring in, I come against it right now. I speak faith. Receive that breakthrough. Receive that deliverance right now. By the power of the word of the Lord. The Lord, bring it to pass. Bring it to pass. In Jesus' name tonight. Yes. Oh, yes, Lord. I decree for you tonight. Yes. Oh, yes, brother. Raise your hand. Give him praise. But God, nothing is too hard for him to do. He did it in the past. He's unchanging, the same yesterday. I decree it right now upon you. With your faith upon you tonight. Yes. I decree that upon you right now. Receive that miracle. Yes, I declare it. I declare it upon your life. In the name of Jesus. Receive tonight. Yes, Lord, receive. It is yours. Yes, Lord. Give him praise, brother. Give him praise. I speak that word tonight that your life is in. Yes, Lord. Let this be a burden in his life tonight. Your hearts be broken tonight. Yes, I declare that the Lord give away tonight. All over your body tonight, yes. I believe that strength upon you. Receive, receive, receive. On the authority of God's word, I speak it forth upon you. Yes, right now upon your mama, Ali. Lord, touch her right now. There's no distance in prayer. Touch by your power, touch by your mind. Oh, Lord, loosen right now and bring it to pass. Give him praise tonight, sister. Oh, yes, give him Father, he can do it for you. Nothing is too hard for you. Give him praise. We give him thanks right now. By the power of the word of the Lord, I decree that. I decree that holy form of the life that you're receiving. In the name of Jesus, that name which is above every other name, received by the word of God, I decree upon your life. By the power of the word of the night, hold forth tonight. Yes, by faith. Decree, Lord, the blessing come by your power and by your might right now upon you. Receive it as you put your feet up. Yes, Lord, I thank you for doing it right now. Receive it in the name of Jesus. I decree upon you, the man, by the power of the Lord, by the promise of heaven and soul. Yes, as you put your feet upon you, receive it. Receive that miracle. Receive that miracle tonight. Yes. Oh, God, nothing is impossible. Yes, I believe it right now. It shall come to pass. Yes, the word of the Lord tonight. Yes. Let it manifest, let it bring forth, let it be fruitful. In the name of Jesus, I decree before you right now, by the power of the word of the Lord, I decree right now before you. In the name of Jesus. Oh, Lord, come, let your anointing flow. Bring forth your faith tonight. Upon you. Right now. Let's receive, receive. Give him praise. You're going to be broken tonight. Yes, I'm just working right now. Yes, God, for the life of the name of Jesus, I decree upon you. I decree upon you right now the authority of the word of God, the power of the Holy Ghost tonight. Yes, right upon you. In the name of Jesus, I decree on the authority of the word. Yes, yes, right now. In Jesus' name. Yes, Lord. Yes, right now, I decree upon you. Nothing is too hard for him, and by faith, I decree down upon you right now. I declare it in Jesus' name. All right, just bear with me for one more minute because I want you to sit. Just see this prayer. Say, Lord Jesus, I am sorry. Oh, yes, a heart right now. Put your hand by your heart, yes. Put it this way right now. Oh, God, you are the heart specialist tonight. Nothing is too hard for you to do. I speak against this infirmity right now. I command it to come out by the authority of the word of God. I decree it is done in Jesus' name. Be made whole tonight. Give him praise. Just raise your hands. Praise him. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Give him praise, Father. We just thank you tonight for that breakthrough. Oh, Lord, we give you praise and we give you thanks. Nothing is too hard for you to do, and we claim it done. In this congregation, lift your hands. Lord, I thank you for all the people that are here tonight. Every brother, every sister. Let healing come. Let deliverance come, Lord God. Things will never be the same again. Breakthrough, breakthrough. In the name of the Lord, what is intended and released to be evil, turn it around and work it for your good so you can get all the honor and all the glory and all the praise. So we thank you. We thank you in advance because the best is yet to come. Give the Lord a hand of praise. Thank you, Pastor, for having me tonight. God bless you.
Human hands, you are
that's the God that we serve. Oh, praise his holy, wonderful name. God bless you, richly. You may be seated.